COVID-19 upended life as we knew it. Globally, no one was spared from the effects of this insidious virus. In March 2020, the bustling streets of our country screeched to a halt. To say no one was prepared for the immediate stop of everyday life is an understatement. While most of us were forced to remain in our homes for our safety, medical professionals and hospital staff put their lives on the line every day to combat the virus. Law enforcement patrolled silent streets, and workers in essential industries risked their health to ensure everyone had resources, even at the bare minimum. But during times of darkness, rays of hope shine. From the brave, kind, and generous, who show us that even in the most difficult of situations, one can make a difference. Extraordinary times demand extraordinary actions. Partners in business and in life, Dr. Z and Aivee Teo are known movers in the beauty industry. When the pandemic hit, like all entrepreneurs across the globe, they faced uncertainty. But they refused to let that get them down. With their determination to help and reach out to the medical community, they showed that true beauty isn't only skin deep. Driven by a passion for beauty and powered by a zeal for business, Dr. Z and Aivee Teo are a constant fixture in the wellness industry. Their business work and family schedules take them all over the globe. That is, until the pandemic brought the world to a standstill.
2 or 3 weeks before that happened, I was already starting to procure supplies, medical supplies like face masks, PPEs and all these things, because we kind of knew that this is what will be needed. If we open the clinics again, we didn't know how long we would have to close. Actually, our first announcement, if you remember, is that we were closed for a week.
And that was very surprising for us. And we were like, okay, that's
and
1 week of no work.
For us, we were like,
one week? It's unthinkable.
Good. And then it just went on and on and on until like...
And I think as doctors, we have this responsibility. It's always been our calling to serve and to be of help. And I think that was the first feelings that we had when this whole lockdown happened and people were panicking and people were scared.
There was one particular post that I still remembered very clearly, and it was of a frontliner that was using garbage bags over their heads, and they cut holes, and it was really sad because for them to use that, because it was completely out. And I think that was when that stirred me and Aivee and said, look, you know, we've got to help them because they're not protected. This garbage bag's not going to help them.
Soon, supplies had dwindled and the challenge was how to secure more.
So it started off with masks because we had supplies. And then there was a need for face shields. So we started making it.
And teaching others how to make it. We didn't feel comfortable just not thinking or planning or doing something. But we felt that there was a calling to do more and to think of ways. That's why at the time we also brought in test kits.
So we wanted to make sure that we try to get in a reliable test kit to be as accurate as possible.
Z would wake up at like 5, 6. Every hour he won't sleep, just being worried whether it's ready or if the orders were put through.
Really, the whole world needs a supply. So the demand outstrips the supply like 100 to 1. So to be able to get these supplies into the Philippines, it's also a challenge. You know, it became like a tug of war.
Once we put out there that we were donating and that we were reaching out to different hospitals and to different health centers, the requests came in so fast. In fact, we were so overwhelmed with the requests that we had to put up a whole team. We've reached out to a lot of hospitals, a lot of health centers. We even go to the market, to the palenques, to the areas where people are there. We personally did the testing for a community together with our team of about 20 to 25 people. We also want to adopt a community. The last one we did was with a tricycle driver. It gives a lot more satisfaction and fulfillment when you're really out there and not just asking other people to do it for you, but you're doing it yourself.
As news of the help spread, more people wanted to join and support the cause.
When everything was closed, our staff and our employees wanted to do their part as well. And so they also worked with us and they said, why don't we also donate food aside from donating PPEs and masks?
We have had people that reached out to us and said, hey, you know, we want to help out what you're doing. We want to be part of this. How can we help? So they have other foundations that give out maybe food, supplies, dental care or something, and they want to join us, then when we are doing our mission drive, they can also do their part as well.
Through their foundation, Beauty Beyond Borders, the power couple continue the culture of giving.
You are blessed by God to have so much resource. We have to give it back.
Through our Beauty Beyond Borders, we're also supporting and providing scholarship to kids for college, their college education, because, you know, it does not end. Help does not end with just this crisis.
Hand in hand with philanthropic activities is growing the business despite the shaky economic climate. Like true entrepreneurs, Dr. Z and Aivee see the silver lining in every crisis.
So there are opportunities always in crisis. So I think let's not be defeatist. Let's not get paralyzed. Let's just open our eyes and go like, hey, let's do something different.
As a group, we innovated and we're focusing now on e-commerce, skincare, home devices. That's our philosophy. When God closes a door, He opens a window. He's always opening something for all of us.
The question is, are you open to go through that window? Right? Because most of the times, we're focused on that door. And if that door is closed, you just whine about it. But all the windows have opened, you don't even want to look.
In the midst of all this, the Teos believe there are lessons to be learned and that the most difficult of times can bring out the best in everyone.
For me, one of the most important lessons I've learned is not to get too attached to the things of this world. It showed me how things can change so fast.
We also wanted to teach our kids the importance of giving, the importance of sharing, the importance of not being just selfish and just thinking for yourselves, but also thinking for others. I think it's always been our mission in life, to live our life with a purpose. And I think it's very sad if you're just living it for yourself.
Through the generosity and willingness to embrace the new, Dr. Z and Aivee Teo are indeed an inspiration. And that's what we look for in these uncertain times, people who show us that we can be more.
Every act of kindness, every act of sharing, every act of support we can give to people who have less than what we have.
When talk of COVID-19 first came out, there was confusion and the proliferation of fake news and misinformation about the virus. The reassuring presence of public health expert Dr. Susan Mercado helped ease anxiety. The public took comfort in her wise words and calm demeanor. Armed with knowledge and powered by information, dealing with COVID was not as insurmountable as it first seemed. Dr. Susan Mercado is the special envoy of the President for Global Health Initiatives and a consultant for the International Federation of the Red Cross and Red Crescent Societies. Her passion for public health began at an early age. An interest in social justice spurred her dream to become not a doctor, but a lawyer.
When I was in college, I wanted to be a lawyer, but my father told me that I would have no future as a lawyer because it was martial law. I was attracted to that idea that there's got to be fairness in society, and that it's something that you need to fight for constantly. In my third year of college, I got sick. I had a very rare disease. I reflected on what happens to a person when you have a life-threatening condition. So at a very young age, my identity was put to test. I decided, yes, maybe I want to become a doctor. So I had graduated, I went back to school, took the pre-med subjects, went into the College of Medicine and became a doctor. And I was still very much concerned about the fairness or the lack of fairness in the health system. My first job was as a community physician for 5 years in a slum in Makati, supported by UNICEF, and got a real feel of what it's like to have very little and to actually have sickness.
With decades of public health service, including a term at the World Health Organization, she is renowned in the medical community.
Actually, I thought I would work for WHO later in my career, but when the opportunity came to work full-time, I thought, well, maybe this is my calling right now to do international public health. And it was a good decision on my part. I enjoyed it and just continued to do that work. And then I became a director for building healthy communities and populations. And then I became the first director for non-communicable disease and health through the life course in the Western Pacific.
Dr. Mercado's friendly and engaging manner made her a familiar presence on TV. She made complicated medical topics and health issues easy to understand. All Dr. Mercado's years in the public health sector prepared her for the unprecedented global crisis, COVID-19.
The most challenging part of the pandemic was trying to get a good picture of what was happening, what was really happening on the ground.
First and foremost, was to clearly communicate the right information amidst all the fake news about the virus.
One of the most important things is to not repeat fake news, but instead to try to understand why people would believe in fake news and to address that.
Paramount was to educate and not instill fear in an already traumatized public.
The key in getting the message across without panicking in public health communication is called risk communication. And essentially what you need to do is to first make sure that you're communicating that we are in the middle of change and that there are uncertainties and that it's okay to feel anxious, to have fear, to have doubts. It's not just about obeying a rule, like don't go out of your house, stay put or we'll catch you. We have to help people understand their risk so that they can do something about it.
According to Dr. Mercado, to make people feel that they have regained control of their lives includes making them understand risks, as well as encouraging new habits and lifestyles in the new normal.
Our behavior is what will keep our home safe in the new normal. Every time you leave the house, we have to just be more aware that you're going out into an environment where you need protection. So before you leave, you have to be ready. In the workplace, the human resource department of every organization or office now has a new task to make sure that the workforce is safe and healthy. And it starts with trying to understand, do people really need to go to work or can they still work from home? That's the first one. The second one is to help people understand their risk and that the risk is threefold. The risk could be in the office, the risk could be in the commute, and the risk could be in the home in terms of recreation or exercise. If you're alone jogging in a park or biking, what is your risk of getting COVID? Very low. You're in a sort of group where you're talking to each other, then you have a greater risk, especially indoor. If you're in a place where there are very few people in a supermarket, your risk is much, much less than going to a market where people are lining up.
Just as important as physical health is one's emotional well-being.
Coping with the pandemic requires being in the moment and enjoying what you have in that moment. Every act of kindness, every act of sharing, every act of support we can give to people who have less than what we have could be a great source of coping, because whatever you do, there's someone who's worse off than you. Use that as a power for change or as a way of helping someone in a very desperate situation.
As for flattening the curve, Dr. Mercado shares the same medical advice echoed all over the globe.
For me, flattening the curve right now means public continues to do preventive measures. This is the most important: hand washing, wearing of masks, social distancing at all times. More vigilant than before. At this point in time of the pandemic, it is very, very important that we strengthen our ability to do contact tracing and our ability to isolate people who are sick and to provide for their need. Because otherwise, people will not go into isolation facilities and they will continue to infect people in their home and in their communities.
Dr. Mercado believes that it doesn't end with the COVID-19 vaccine, nor does it stop when the last quarantine center is closed. True victory lies in ending poverty, in equal access to resources and better health for every Filipino.
The fight for public health is about making sure that every single person in the community is equally informed and equally able to have access to resources for prevention. We've seen in this pandemic that if you have no water in your home, you can't wash your hands. If you live in a 20 square meter home and there are five of you, you can't do social distancing. So let's not forget that when a vaccine or a cure comes. Because we can't vaccinate or cure people and send them back to the conditions that made them sick.
From a child dreaming of social justice to a doctor advocating health for all, for Dr. Susan Mercado, where she is now is truly the path she was meant to take.
So I think what keeps me going is my training and my experience and my faith that somehow I was meant to do something in this moment.
With information comes understanding. Thank you, Dr. Mercado, for showing us the way.
And we are all cheering each other on. So we have to be united because there's one common enemy. We're not competing with each other. One common enemy is COVID.
It is said that booming tourism reflects a country's pride. But what happens when all flights are canceled, resorts are empty, and borders start to shut? Join me as we look at how one woman didn't let this pandemic stop her from declaring love of country and promoting the nation. How Secretary Berna Romulo-Puyat showed us that the best way to move forward is with a smile. Secretary Berna Romulo-Puyat, tourism's brightest star. As Secretary of Tourism since 2018, she has been admired for her stance against corruption while tirelessly promoting the country with her signature flair and style. Tourism numbers hit their highest in 2019. The country seemed to be back on track on everyone's to-visit list until COVID-19 happened.
January of this year, we were up by tourism arrivals were up by 8.8%, revenues increased by 9.9%. Pero nung February, nung napag-uusapan na ang COVID, nagkaka-travel ban na, unti-unti na siyang bumabagsak until nung March, may travel restrictions not only all over the country but all over the world. We all did not know what hit us. Tapos maraming, yung syempre naiiyak dahil nawalan ng trabaho. Tourism nung 2019 employed 5.7 million Filipinos. And it's heartbreaking to know na ang daming nawalan ng trabaho, pero parang at that time, there was no light at the end of the tunnel. And at that time pa, I was naka-room quarantine kasi I was exposed 4 times. So sabi ko, ano ba mangyayari dito sa, paano, di ba traveling is about, it's physical. You go around, you ride the plane, it's experiences. So kapasan tayo pupulutin ito?
Secretary Puyat quickly attended to the first problem at hand, assisting stranded tourists in the country.
Sabi ko, no, this cannot be. Hindi pwede, you cannot give up. When the pandemic hit, the irony of it all, di ba ang trabaho namin is supposed to be inbound? Ang trabaho namin, we stage sweeper flights para lang yung mga stranded foreign tourists makaalis ng bansa. Sabi ko, parang baliktad. Pero syempre, that's how it has to be. Stranded sila kasi there were no domestic flights. So, yun, tinulungan namin sila hanggang makaalis sila. So, tuloy-tuloy pa rin yon kasi you really, ganun naman ang Pilipino eh. Ang bisita talaga habang nasa bahay mo, nasa bansa mo, you will take care of them.
With planes grounded and beaches empty despite the hot and sunny summer, Secretary Puyat's next move was to pay tribute to the real gems of tourism, the Filipino people, frontliners dedicating their lives to the country.
At the height of the ECQ, and then I was talking to our Assistant Secretary for Branding. And of course, that was not the time to promote the country. People actually come here because of the Filipino people. We're so hospitable. We think of others more than ourselves. We always felt that the strength of the country was the Filipino people. At saka napansin mo ang mga Pilipino, kahit na grabe nang nangyayari sa atin, may jokes pa rin, nagpapatawa pa rin, we still manage to smile. So what I did, out of the blue, I just texted Ellie. I go, "Hi Ellie, how are you? I thought of your With a Smile video. Can I use your song?" And you know what? Agad, of course you can use it for free. So I think that's why it was very touching, because talagang tama, alam natin na yan ang Pilipino kasi. In fact, when we posted that, you know that in 2 days, we had 2 million views. It was our way of paying tribute to all our frontliners, not only the healthcare workers, to the bank employees, to the BPOs, delivery. It was our way of saying thank you to them.
After boosting morale with a smile, Noypi took it a step further by honoring Filipino frontliners all over the world.
That was to give tribute to all the healthcare workers all over the world. Because, di ba, all over the world, ang nurses, puro Pilipino. And sabi namin, wow, they're not only taking care of the country, they're taking care of the whole world.
Determined to lead despite all the fears in tourism industry, Secretary Puyat thought of ways to reach out.
We really had to think out of the box. And then we realized by doing online, mas marami kaming taong nare-reach. Normally, when you have a seminar, you're only limited to 50 people kasi face-to-face. Ngayon, wow, like our first webinar, our online learning series, we had 500 already from Luzon, Visayas, and Mindanao. We've reached so many people. We talked about digitalization, e-commerce, Filipino brand of service during the time of the pandemic. So it was very important for the DOT to reinvent ourselves.
Slowly, tourism can help restart the economy. But according to Secretary Puyat, only through strict safety protocol.
People who I didn't know would text me, ask me, "When will COVID end?" And I lost my job. Paano ko napapakainin yung mga anak ko? I'm a solo parent. So I know that how will you make both ends meet? Paano? So yung motivation ko talaga is we cannot give up because we really need to restart tourism slow but safe. Safe but sure. As early as May, we already discussed with the private sector all the health and safety protocols, guidelines with accommodations, transport, tourist transport, MICE facilities, and also tour guides, etc., and even restaurants. These were in accordance with the World Health Organization and the Department of Health. It's important to work with the local government units, yung mga governor, yung mga mayor, kasi sila mag-i-implement. A lot of the tourist spots are hesitant to open, but we think of it as a good sign kasi they are cautious. When they finally reopen, you know that everybody will be safe, not only for the visitors, the tourists, but also for the residents at those working in the establishments. Then eventually, we're looking at travel bubbles or travel corridors. So we can actually do that. We can pair up a country with no COVID cases or walang COVID cases in 30 days or low cases. They can go directly, let's say, to Boracay na zero COVID. Let's say may magka-temperature, may magka-COVID symptoms, agad may isolation room, tested again, and the hospitals should be equipped for any emergency. I'm confident that tourism will slowly but surely restart.
Encouraging tourism also means sharing best practices with our ASEAN neighbors.
I learned when I met with my fellow ASEAN tourism ministers that we were all on the same boat. And we are all cheering each other on. So we have to be united because there's one common enemy. We're not competing with each other. One common enemy is COVID.
Secretary Puyat's brand of leadership can also be credited to lessons imparted to her by her father, Alberto Romulo, a senator, ASEAN chairman, and a valued cabinet secretary for two influential presidents.
My dad would always tell me that just do what is right, especially if it will benefit a lot of people, especially if it will benefit your stakeholders. You have to have an open line of communication. If they have a problem, they can always come to me. So it's very important that you're always talking to your stakeholders, good or bad. Sometimes it's so easy to surround yourself with only people who say good things. But I like talking to people who will give you constructive criticism, because that's the only way you can learn. It's important that you go. Still, nothing beats that you're there listening to them. And kasi each tourist spot will have a different problem.
Secretary Puyat also shares what keeps her going and motivated.
What keeps me inspired? My children. I'm a solo parent. My husband died 10 years ago. And everything I do is really for my children. And then now, really my DOT family.
Strength, beauty, resilience. Words that describe not just Secretary Berna Romulo-Puyat, but also the country she loves so dearly.
Tourism is about love for country, love for local. There's so much things, many things to love about our country. And when we're proud of our country, that's what tourism is all about.
It is true that the wealth of a nation are its people, those who inspire us to be better, who go the extra mile to extend a helping hand, those who, despite what seems impossible, rise to the occasion. Inspiring people that pave the way for more stories to tell.